I'm Jim Turner, and welcome to dLifeTV Online. It's going to be a great show in a new place. We'll be here Sundays at 7 p.m. Eastern, 4 p.m. Pacific, with new shows about living your dLife. Every week, we'll be sharing insights, recipes from the dLife kitchen, stories about real people living and achieving with diabetes, and so much more. We're glad you're here. Now on with the show. It's no surprise to find Kerry Brown in the gym.
I grew up playing a lot of sports.
Kerry played 4 years of college basketball at Davidson and kept on competing after her graduation.
I started actually pretty much 2 years ago doing triathlon. I did pretty well with them. I did one Olympic distance and one sprint distance, and placed first and third in my age group, which was pretty surprising. I had worked hard, but didn't know what I had.
Appreciating what she had is easy now.
Then I ran into the diabetes, so it was an interesting transition.
This could be an inspirational story about an athlete with diabetes making a comeback. Instead, it's a story about bringing diabetes patients together.
We can be learning from each other and get an idea of our challenges and what works and what doesn't, so that moving forward, we can take little pieces of that and add it to our workout regimen. Just wanted to thank you guys all for being here. I'd love for every single person in this class to walk out of the class feeling inspired to just take one little step to do a little bit more physical activity.
I say exercise is medicine.
Joy Pape is a certified diabetes educator and nurse who has worked with diabetes patients for 31 years.
Exercise is particularly important for people who have diabetes because, number one, it lowers blood sugar.
Of course, getting people to exercise isn't always easy.
What's the biggest excuse? I don't have time. My answer to that is we find time for the things we want to do.
It doesn't have to happen in a gym. Find an excuse to walk instead of driving a car or taking a bus. It's important for the body and the mind.
Also, it helps relieve stress, and it helps people who have diabetes feel like they're more in control of their diabetes.
The diagnosis might be the most stressful time of all.
It was probably the hardest day that I've ever gone through.
Kerry amped up her training in 2008, but her diet and her body were changing.
I started buying tons of carbohydrates, like lots of orange juice, yogurts, heavy pastas, all this stuff that I hadn't really eaten a lot before of, but I was craving it so much. I was probably drinking about 20 bottles of water a day. So then I started losing weight. I lost about 12 pounds by the end of it.
Her twin sister Jamie, also an athlete, contacted a doctor who suggested a blood test. Hours later, Kerry got the news.
I think my sugars were at about 560 when I was diagnosed. They hospitalized me for 2 days.
For a woman used to moving straight ahead, Kerry's life was suddenly taking sharp turns.
To hear that I'm going to be giving myself 5 shots a day in order to live, it's earth-shattering. It completely changes every bit of who you are and where you are in your life. It collapsed me. It probably took about 6 months to start to feel normal again. And that is both emotionally and physically.
During that time, Kerry found other diabetes patients sharing information.
I actually started watching dLifeTV. I went on all the websites. I did whatever I could to get as much information as I could.
So she came to dLife with the idea to get people together to share what she knows best.
dLife has been amazing in just like supporting this effort and just getting this first class off the ground. And I think it'd be exciting to start to get these support groups meeting on a regular basis to work out together and be more fit. Fitness is so positive. It's empowering, and it actually has allowed me to manage my blood sugars so that they're very regulated. I started to see, hey, you know what? This actually can be a great opportunity. This can be an exciting thing for me to learn how to take care of my health more, perhaps inspire other people, and all that stuff.
Beginning a workout regimen can be tricky.
especially for a diabetes patient.
So your best bet is to look at the numbers.
Check your blood sugar levels. We can do that right now.
After about 15 minutes, the class stopped to measure their sugars.
If their blood glucose is low, they may need to stop, get something to eat.
Snacks were nearby, too.
This is low blood sugar fast.
It's a tricky, sometimes frustrating, but necessary balancing act.
It's nice getting everybody together and making it a group effort.
There's nothing better than bringing people together. I found the best medicine for me was meeting another diabetic.
Which brings us back to Kerry Brown, the triathlete who happens to have diabetes.
I wanted to create a way for diabetics to feel comfortable and help them figure out ways to incorporate fitness in their day-to-day life instead of seeing all these really amazing stories about these people who are overcoming such huge things. How can diabetes and fitness work together in your day-to-day life?
Hi, I'm Chef Michel Nashan, and welcome to the dLife Kitchen. Now, when you think of a souffle, do you picture a French chef with a poofy hat worrying that someone's going to make a noise and cause his souffle to collapse? Well, souffles have a certain cachet, and people just assume that they're fancy, gourmet, too hard to make at home. Well, here's the thing. They're not. Souffle just means puffed up. And a souffle is just beaten egg yolks folded with beaten egg whites and baked until it puffs up. Now, we stabilize it with a little bit of roux, and I'm going to show you how to do that. It's the easiest thing in the world. So here, check it out. I have a saute pan, and I'm putting it over about a medium flame, and I have some cut up butter. I'm going to add that. I'm going to add a little bit of celery, and then on the celery, I'm going to put some chopped raw garlic. And we're going to saute this until the celery is fragrant and just starts to soften a little bit. Now I can add my other stuff. I have some red pepper flake, then we have some dried herbs, a little bit of curry powder. Now we have all these scents developed. I'm going to put a little bit of flour in here. There's not too much, and this souffle serves quite a few people, so it's not that big of a deal. Now crab is awesome, canned crab. First of all, it's really high in protein, low carb, almost no carb, nice and sweet. It's got a lot of really great nutrients. Now I'm taking the roux off of the fire, so that I can add the milk to it slowly so that it doesn't kind of like bubble up and get lumpy on me. Just going to kind of stir it in, and then you'll see that when I put it back on the fire, it's going to slowly come to a simmer, and then it's going to thicken. Now, soufflés, what I love about them is they're really great crust-free substitute for occasions that might call for something like a quiche. So really awesome and really not that difficult. You can see that everything that I did here, you can do. Now, this is about fully thickened. So I'm going to take it off the fire and I'm going to add some egg yolk to it while it's hot. Now, this is important because the egg yolks have to cook a little bit and you want to move them fairly quickly because you don't want them to scramble. But if the egg's cooking, it kind of like creates a raft, and you can see that the sauce is even getting thicker. Now that I have the egg yolks in here, I'm just going to transfer it into this mixing bowl. Next, we're going to add some toasted coconut and some crab, and this is going to help us cool the souffle base so that when we whip the egg whites, we can add them in without any trouble. Now, you might be thinking, with diabetes, you're living with diabetes, there's butter in here, you know, egg yolks in here. These natural saturated fats are not the evil villains we've been led to believe over the years. They're really quite good. It's the trans fats that you have to watch out for. This is a beautiful souffle plate. Now we're going to whip the egg whites. And this is the important part, because it's really the egg whites that make the souffle rise. So we just put them in a mixer. Put in a pinch of salt, and then turn on the mixer. And this is just going to take about a minute, and then we'll have perfect egg whites. Now we're taking these egg whites to stiff peak, and stiff peak pretty much means when the eggs in the mixer look like they're kind of like whipped cream, and when you take the bowl off and you pull the whisk out, and you can see that peak in the middle and on the end of the whisk stands up straight. That is stiff peak, very important. Okay, now we're gonna start folding, and we're gonna fold. I just kind of turn the bowl and turn the mixture at the same time, and you can see little ribbons of egg whites in here. This is a good thing. So if you overfold, the souffle has a greater chance of collapsing. Now I have a pre-buttered souffle dish, just rubbed probably about, a half a tablespoon of butter evenly on the inside of the dish, because this is going to keep the souffle from sticking to the sides, which is something that will keep it from rising, and also make it easier to get the souffle out of the dish when you're serving it. I give it just a good shake, and then I take the end of my spatula and just poke it down in the middle, and that's going to create a little bit of an air jacket, and that way the souffle is going to rise evenly. And then I put it in a preheated 400 degree oven, and we're going to bake this puppy for about 45 minutes. So that gives us plenty of time to clean up the kitchen. So I'll see you back here in 45 minutes with a perfect souffle. Look at this. Now, the souffle will deflate after about 5 minutes out of the oven, so don't worry about it. It doesn't mean that you did anything wrong. It just means that it's out of that hot environment. Now, you can take this basic technique, and instead of the crab meat, you can substitute pureed vegetables, shredded cheese, really anything, mushrooms, chicken, doesn't matter, or even chocolate for dessert. So really, really good stuff here. Now, you can find this recipe and thousands more like it at dlife.com/recipebox. And after trying it out, don't forget to go back to the site, write a review, tell us about it, tell us how it turned out. I'm Chef Michel Nashan. See you next time in the dLife Kitchen.
Oh, hello. I'm James Turner. And our film tonight is the silent movie classic, The Perilous Pitfalls of Restaurant Dining. Our hero, Jim, has diabetes, and apparently dining out with this disease is quite a challenge. Who knew? The film is a non-stop drama of the perils of living with his condition. Well, let's watch and see what happens after our hero prematurely takes his shot before dinner. Apparently, in diabetes, timing is everything. So Jim needs to eat soon, but of course, his date is late. Confronted with the tortures of leisurely dining, he gets desperate. And eventually, our hero takes matters into his own hands. Even back then, there was an embarrassment about needing to take care of your disease in a public setting. Testing your blood sugar with a world watching has never been easy. Jim tests often, as one with diabetes should, but what is ordinary for the diabetes sufferer might seem less than romantic to those unused to the rituals of daily testing. Scene, our hero tries desperately to find out what exactly is in the mystery sauce on the spaghetti. He's calibrated his insulin carefully, but a little hidden flour or possibly something worse could change his insulin needs dramatically. What is that flavor? Our hero realizes the stunning truth. Since the dawn of baking, the parade of bread and rolls and crackers and bread has never been an easy one for people with diabetes. This movie has it all: drama, tragedy, mystery, conflict. And lots of laughs. I'd recommend The Perilous Pitfalls of Restaurant Dining to anyone interested in diabetes. Well, thanks for watching. Next week, we'll be looking at the depiction of diabetes in the films of Cary Grant and Katharine Hepburn.
A teenager's life can be unpredictable. But when you add diabetes to the mix, the challenges for a 13-year-old can be overwhelming.
Some of my challenges of diabetes in middle school is just trying to make sure that people don't really notice and they don't treat me differently or just think be sorry for me. Because when you're in middle school, you're running around and you're with all your friends and stuff, so you don't really want to worry about that.
Camilla was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes at the age of 10.
We were not sure of what diabetic symptoms would be. We thought she was having some sort of growth spur or a virus. We continued to see a very rapid loss of weight. And then she was drinking water tremendously, and she was also going to the bathroom to pee.
One day my parents took me to a restaurant, and I usually order water or something that's not too sugary. And I ordered a fruit punch that day. And so I drank it, and my parents noticed that I was kind of drooping down a little and I wasn't feeling good.
We called a friend of mine that's a physical trainer, and he's also a diabetic, and he told me if I were you, I would really take her to either a hospital or
an emergency room. When we were at the emergency, they told us she had to go straight to the hospital because her numbers were 800 on the 800. And we didn't realize she was that sick.
At first, I thought they were joking. And then I thought, well, they look pretty serious, so I knew it was true. And then I thought, was I going to die? Was I going to have to stay in the hospital for the rest of my life? Was I going to be like a vegetable? I thought many things. And then I just cried for a while.
Even before the initial shock wore off, Camilla and her parents met Sarah Scott. Sarah is a diabetes educator in Orlando, Florida. She's also been living with diabetes herself for over 20 years.
I walked in the room and I saw Camilla and her parents, and they were very, very distraught and very, very sad. And I think one of the first things I tell people is I have diabetes. And once I say that and they look at me and they say, you look normal, you look fine, you don't look sick, then they kind of relaxed and knew it was going to be okay.
The beginning is very hard on the emotional level, because it was like a denial process. She didn't want to deal with it. We have to do everything for her, the testing, the shots, the food.
But as the months passed, her mom says something clicked for Camilla.
It takes time to get there, but she's very responsible and knows that the quality of life she's going to have in the future depends on the management that she takes of diabetes right now.
I think as the kids get older and as Camilla is getting into her teenage years, becoming more and more independent with your diabetes is great, because if Camilla does not know what to do when she's low, how to troubleshoot when she's high, she's going to have to stay with her parents all the time. They're not going to trust for her to go to a friend's house to spend the night, or to go away on trips, or to go away to college.
One tool that has helped Camilla to better manage her blood sugar is the 360 worksheet, a unique logging system.
So let me see your 360 view. Did you fill that out for me?
Yeah.
What we can teach a family to do at home with the 360 is to take 3 days, and then they can start to see trends at home and make those adjustments, or even contact the office to make suggestions of what they need to do. So in between visits, they can make those adjustments so that when they come to the office, they have a great hemoglobin A1C and good blood sugars.
Camilla has traveled all around Florida and as far as London to speak about her diabetes.
The whole traveling and the whole meeting new people with diabetes was why I wanted to do it initially. And seeing if what I did could help people with diabetes, I know that I'm not alone in this, and I know that I'm not the only one who has it. So I'm not alone.
Through it all, her family and friends have been her support system.
Some of my friends have changed as my support group over the years, as I've grown up, as I've gone to middle school, as I've changed into different schools, but they still support me, and I have some of my best friends. They're still always there for me. They always make sure that my sugar's okay.
And while her future is uncertain, she knows that in order to lead a healthy life, she needs to take responsibility for her diabetes.
If I do have any expectations, it's to have better blood sugars than I do now, because I know that when you're a teenager, everything changes and your body's changing. So of course your sugar is going to be changing, and I want to make sure that I'm fit.
That's the show for today. Thanks for tuning in. I know I learned a lot, and I want to know what you think. So be sure to share your thoughts in the comments below, and I'll see you here next Sunday, 7 p.m. Eastern, 4 p.m. Pacific, for another exciting episode of dLife TV Online. Thank you.